I'm Mishka, and this channel is the Helsinki Renaissance, where we will be talking about arts and culture in hopefully a very innovative and game-changing a manner, which we probably won't, but since we are talking about Finnish New Wave movies, not French New Wave movies, although a telling slip on my part, because the Finnish New Wave is so ridiculously derivative of the French New Wave. But I already did one video about the Finnish New Wave, just a loose overall sketch of the scene around the films, and then opinions on a couple of the movies involved. Unfortunately, I ran out of time before I could address some of the main movies in the movement, and as a result, I initially thought that perhaps my Finnish New Wave sketch wasn't good enough, but when I rewatched the video, I actually thought that it came out quite well. My only problem was that I slightly regretted calling Jörn Donner as like Finland's equivalent of Luciano Visconti, because I think it's the comparison is apt up to a point, but then like the difference, I mean, like the problem is that Visconti has certain levels to his game that Jörn Donner doesn't, so it's like you'd have to take out the three huge epics that Visconti has, Senso, the Leopard, and Rocco and his brothers. If you take those three out of Visconti's filmography, then like it'd be sort of more apparent. But anyway, like it says that because I think a lot of Visconti, and it's not that I don't appreciate Jörn Donner, but like he clearly isn't on the same level of being like you know, a huge international talent. But anyway, like when I was going over that first video, like that was the only thing that I would have like slightly wanted to, you know, qualify. But obviously that's just a minor thing, and the bigger thing is that I'm sure lots of audiences would be either surprised or frustrated that I did a video about the Finnish New Wave and I didn't talk about any of the most iconic or representative films of the Finnish New Wave. So I thought that the logical thing to do would be to make a second video where I talk about what I would imagine are the two major major moments that didn't make it into the first video. I would say that the one director the most prominent director that I didn't mention at all in the first video is a Finnish director called Erkko Kivikoski. And I happened to see a film of his called Kesällä, Kello, Viisi recently, I actually watched a couple of other Erkko Kivikoski movies, such as a film called Kuuma, Kissa, which is another somewhat neglected Finnish new wave. I suppose you could call it a high point of sorts. But anyway, so Erkko Kivikoski would be just the kind of a director who arguably should have been mentioned in the first video, but since I was running out of time, I just didn't. Although, like, how should I put it? I'm not trying to be rude, but perhaps it's telling that certain Finnish New Wave films have fallen off the radar. Like somebody might make the argument that some of the films of that movement have become, they've aged rather poorly, and because of that, they are, somebody might say, neglected for a reason. But I would counter that by saying that there are certain dated film, or like films that have been pretty poorly dated, that have aged poorly. Like some movies of that sort are still in the cultural consciousness, and the Erkko Kivikoski movies, for instance, they aren't any less worthy of notice than anything else in the Finnish New Wave. So that's why Erkko Kivikoski really should be part of any discussion about the Finnish New Wave. But anyway, so if I'd briefly discuss two Erkko Kivikoski movies that I think are that most belong to the story of the Finnish New Wave. And the two are Kesällä, Kello, Viisi, so 5 o'clock summer time might be a kind of a translation. And I know that lots of people would want to hear of Laukaustehtaalla, gunshots at the factory. However, I think it's a pretty bad movie, so I don't want to talk about it. So, Kesällä, Kello, Viisi, 5 o'clock summer time, and then the other movie, Kuuma, Kissa, which literally means a hot cat. But, I mean, like, it would have connotations to what was in the late 50s, early 60s. There was such a thing in cinema as the sex kitten type movies, where the movie's whole raison d'être would be that, you know, Brigitte Bardot is, you know, she's like considered to be really hot. And lots of people will watch any kind of half-baked movie just because the lead actress is considered to be, you know, so hot that people will walk 10 miles to see her do anything. So, like, Brigitte Bardot, she was like Europe's answer to, like, Marilyn Monroe movies. Like, Marilyn Monroe, she has a couple of, like, slightly bigger classics because there's, like, some higher artistry to them. In that, you know, directors like Billy Wilder and John Huston, they had no intention of, or Howard Hawks, they had no intention of doing a film badly just because the audience would accept it, because they would have, like, non-artistic reasons for seeing a Marilyn Monroe movie. Like, Marilyn Monroe movies, they are slightly a different case than Brigitte Bardot movies, where a lot of Brigitte Bardot movies are just sort of like you know, self-consciously nothing more than vacant eye candy. I'd say that Erkko Kivikoski film Kuuma, Kissa, it's sort of like it's halfway part of that tradition, which, by the way, should be recognized that it's like that sex kitten stuff, it basically has nothing to do with the new wave. So, like, even in Finland, there is, like, a bit of tradition of those types of sex kitten movies that they precede the new wave. So, Anneli Sauli was, like, Finland's answer to Brigitte Bardot, in that she was, extremely attractive for whatever that's worth. Some movies like Hilja Maitotyttö, so Hilja the Milkmaid, is like, it's a movie that's basically built around the cleavage of the leading lady. So, like, there are scenarios in the movie where, just like Leonardo DiCaprio in Titanic, like, some of the eroticism in a period piece is built around the kind of convenient pretext that the Leonardo DiCaprio character is an artist, and, you know, what artists do is sometimes they sketch nude portraits. So, just like Kate Winslet has, like, you know, a good reason to get naked in Titanic, you know, I mean, she's doing it for the art. So, Anneli Sauli in Hilja Maitotyttö, she's showing her breasts because she has a crush on an artist. So, like, the movie's like halfway almost being innocent and yet shamelessly calculating at the same time. And there was another Finnish movie called Kuon Vaarallinen, which, you know, I translate as something like Dangerous Moonlight or something. And it is like this kind of relationship movie, like a more disposable version of, like, Elia Kazan's Baby Doll or something. But anyway, like, Kuon Vaarallinen, The Dangerous Moonlight, you know, it is that kind of a movie where it's just built around the idea that a leading lady considered really attractive will, like, show off her assets, as it were. Like, those are, like, from a storytelling standpoint, those are, like, self-consciously completely mindless as movies. And so, like, in continental Europe and in Finland, there was a bit of a tradition of those kinds of sex kitten movies before the new wave and before any Kuuma, Kissa movies. The Kuuma, Kissa movie by Erkko Kivikoski, if I'd address it first, it doesn't come from the same tradition as that Hilja Maitotyttö or Kuon Vaarallinen movie. So, if Hilja Maitotyttö and Kuon Vaarallinen, if those were, like, self-consciously mindless as movies, and they accepted it because they were just, you know, those movies were designed for no other reason beside making easy money, you know, with the lowest common denominator approach to the audience. Like, those are just movies for profit and for nothing else. like with Kuuma Kissa, it is not exactly a mindless movie. It's a movie that is ambitious, and it's ambitious to be something more artistic. However, it is just as shameless with seeing the kind of, you know, sex sales as like at least half of its raison d'etre. So if anyone thinks that it's a movie where it just happens to have nudity, like, I mean, like, please, no one in the audience can be that naive. Like, I mean, it's a movie where it's designed to give itself a chance for the spotlight through the willingness of the leading lady to be naked. And that Kuuma Kissa movie, like, it is, like, arguably just a better version of, say, those types of kuonvaarallinen movies. So, I won't give it a pass just because it's ambitious, but I would say that as far as the Finnish New Wave movies are concerned, I think that Kuuma Kissa movie, I actually think that it is rather good. As far as purely the mise-en-scène is concerned, I think Kuuma Kissa is a movie that has its moments, and if anyone would be willing to care about Finnish New Wave movies, I think Kuuma Kissa would probably, like, if some people would make, like, you know, top 10s of Finnish New Wave movies, and I think the movement has enough quality to fill out a top 10. Like, you'd probably have quite a, like, multiple Risto Jarva and Mikko Niskanen movies in the top 10, but, like, you could fill it out. I think Kuuma Kissa would probably just, like, it would probably just make, like, one of the latter spots in my top 10. I think it has its moments, but, you know, like, the thing is that, how should I put it? Like, if some of those hiljamaitetut movies, if they are, like, self-consciously mindless, I think, like, the Kuuma Kissa movie, it's, like, a different kind of mindless. Like, it has ambitions, which is why, I mean, it both is and isn't mindless, because, like, I think the thing is that, if you take a British movie called Notes on a Scandal, like, the reason why I think that that's, like, a more interesting version of the same story as that Kuuma Kissa movie, because both movies have a situation where there's a teacher and a student and they come to have a relationship. But, like, the difference is that that Notes on a Scandal movie, it's all about navigating through the shades of gray of the situation. And, like, I think that the secret strength to that Notes on a Scandal movie is that the Judi Dench character is so brilliantly written. Like, she's there to be a counterbalance to everything else. And that kind of counterbalance is what is missing from the Kuuma Kissa movie. And because of that, it sort of appears mindless. Because of the lack of counterbalance, it seems like there's no shades of gray. It's just that, like the movie has its own convictions, it has its own messages, and it's just sort of going through them without any kind of more complicated moments. So that's why, like, I'd say that Kuuma, Kissa, it's a reasonably well-directed a movie. I think the screenplay is completely horrible, and then the shamelessness of selling it with sex, like, that's another mark against it. But, like, that Kuuma, Kissa movie, like, I think it's just good enough to, like, you could sort of see, like how you could, like, halfway recommend it to somebody. But anyway, I don't want to talk further about that Kuuma, Kissa movie. Yeah, I mean, like, my problem with the Finnish New Wave comes in with those movies is that I think they set the bar for themselves incredibly low. Like, it's a movie that has its moments. It has a couple of, like, more unique moments of, like, directorial decisions, like, which should be the whole point of the New Wave, that there's a more innovative type of filmmaking. Like, it has just a couple of moments where, you know, you're not putting the audience to sleep, even when the ladies are, you know, having their clothes on. I would say that, you know, if in that first New Wave movie, I talked about some of the Jörn Donner movies with, like, sex sales theme to them, I'd say that that Kuuma, Kissa was like a better version of those films, like Nais and Kuvi, or what was the other that I mentioned? 69. So yeah, like, I'd put that Kuuma, Kissa movie into the same tradition as, like, Nais and Kuvi, as, like, a semi-intelligent-ish trash movie. I mean, I'm not trying to be rude, but that's as much of a compliment as I can give it, because, like, it's not a sample of what I'd see as like a highly artistic production. But, you know, it's like, you could halfway see that it could be, like, just good enough. But anyway, then the other Erkko Kivikoski movie, Kesällä, Kello, Viisi, which, like, I think in Finland it's enjoying a position as, like, a minor classic of Finnish cinema, and perhaps somebody might even call it, like, a almost like a major classic of the Finnish New Wave. But if somebody would, it's only because the Finnish New Wave doesn't have enough major classics that it would be, you know, like, the kind of group that it's difficult to get into. So, classic as of a big fish, small pond type situation. But anyway, Kesällä, Kello, Viisi, like, if I'd have to compare it to anything else in the other New Waves, you know, it, like, I mean, I don't, that Kuuma, Kissa movie, I think it's sort of recognizably New Wave, but I'd almost call Kesällä, Kello, Viisi, 5 o'clock summertime, I'd almost call it like a pseudo-New Wave movie, because to me it just seems to, like, superficially take some of the loose overall tonalities sort of associated with the international New Waves. So Kesällä, Kello, Viisi, like, you know, it has a Henry Mancini type jazz score to it. And I guess when it was released, some people thought that that was like, that there was something modern about like a jazz score. So like the way that Louis Malle's Elevator to the Gallows has Miles Davis on it. I guess some people thought that, you know, just putting jazz on a movie makes it modern, although the way that some movies use jazz scores, it they almost like make it sound like elevator music. So like I would sort of call into question like the whole point of seeing like a jazz score as being some sort of enough said moment about the film's new wave credentials. So anyway, like the reason why I said that 5 o'clock summertime it just sort of superficially takes a couple of loose new wave-ish tonalities is like the jazz score is one, but I think it's just duping people into thinking that it's somehow more groundbreaking than it is. The other thing is that the main point of 5 o'clock summertime is that there's like what might be termed a modern relationship in that there's two people both feeling slight cases of ennui, and you know, the boy and a girl, they're in a relationship, but because of their you know, hapless ennui, the boy decides that perhaps they'd be better off breaking up. For the first act they're together, for the second act they've broken up, and for the third act they try to get back together. And, you know, just like a movie that nearly recognizes the existence of those modern type relationships, like, again, to me, that seems like it's just there to dupe people into thinking that it's that there's something groundbreaking going on. But like in reality, like watching 5 o'clock summertime, I thought that it was basically like a music video. Like there's a certain kind of accomplishment to how it is directed. So like Erkko Kivikoski, I think he's showing sort of just enough abilities as a director. I think that how some of the compositions are done, like the flow of the movie, it's all rather smooth. But like, I mean, if a movie can be like elevator music, I think Kesällä, Kello, Viisi is that. So, you know, like, I think it's actually an even more mindless a movie than those Hilja Maitotyttö, you know, Hilja the Milkmaid, that movies where like, if that movie just tried to be a cash grab with sex, I think Kesällä, Kello, Viisi tries to be a cash grab with its modernism. So, like, you know, it's status as a major classic to me, it's just, like, to me, that's the ultimate indictment of the Finnish New Wave as a not very major a moment in cinema history. So, anyway, now I feel like I addressed Erkko Kivikoski, who, you know, I'd say that of what I've seen of him, his films seem fairly well directed, but extremely badly scripted. So that's merely my opinion. Other people seem to rate them more highly, but my opinions are what they are. But anyway, then the other, like, if Finnish New Wave movies would be represented with just one movie, Ruusujen Aika, the Time of the Roses by Risto Jarva, like, I'm sure that everyone in Finland who, you know, has the slightest knowledge of cinema history, if they had to represent the Finnish New Wave with just one movie, like the only possible consensus choice, or no, wait, I'm sorry. No, there's two logical consensus choices. One of them is Käpy selän alla by Mikko Niskanen, A Pine Cone Under One's Back, or whatever the international English language title is. But Käpy selän alla, like, it would probably be the one that everyone thinks of first. But then, like, after thinking a bit about things a bit more, I think Ruusujen aika, I think that this is actually what people would probably settle on. You know, this, I think, if I remember correctly, there's probably three movies that Risto Jarva did where he scripted them with Jaakko Pakkasvirta and Peter von Baag. So, I can't offhand remember what the other two were, but they collaborated on a couple of instances, and this is the most famous of them. Now, I think that whatever makes, like, I think both the good and the bad in this movie is, I think, best introduced through that trio of screenwriters. So to me, how the situation goes is that, you know, Akira Kurosawa was a film director who could also work as a screenwriter. Now, you know, if Kurosawa merely wanted a script, he could write it himself. So he could write a script with ease. But the thing is that if he wants to keep raising the bar with the quality of the script, what Kurosawa did is that he invited co-writers because he recognized that that he had certain kinds of tendencies, and Kurosawa left to his own devices, a bit like Steven Spielberg, would get excessively sentimental. This is the pre-Dodeskaden Kurosawa. Obviously, the post-Dodeskaden Kurosawa is erring on bleakness and, you know, cynicism. But the pre-Dodeskaden Kurosawa, that Kurosawa recognized that left to his own devices, he became more sentimental than was good for the movie. So because Kurosawa, he was a true professional, and he didn't just want to brute force his own ideas through the production, he wanted to do what he saw as best for the movie. So he sometimes had one, sometimes two or three co-writers, and those co-writers were picked because they were different from Kurosawa, because they brought different elements that Kurosawa wouldn't have himself picked for the movie. But anyway, the reason why I say this is because Risto Jarva, Peter von Baag, and Jaakko Pakkasvirta, they aren't chosen because they are the three most different kind of people to put for the production. Like, they are essentially three versions of the same writer. So, like, they were chosen because of their similarities, because they enjoyed working with each other. Like, they were friends before they were colleagues, you could say. And, like, with that, you know, if I said that that Notes on a Scandal movie, like, if it has any kind of quality to it, it has quality because it has shades of grey, because different elements are there to counterbalance each other. And the problem with the Kuuma Kissa is that it has no counterbalance to it, because it's just you know, it's just there's nothing in the movie that's going against the grain with regards to itself. Like, it's there to be like a counterculture movie, but it's a counterculture movie that just believes in its own message, and it believes its own message in a completely mindless manner, and it just doesn't create any interesting tensions to it. So anyway, I certainly think that Time of the Roses has certain kinds of tensions, but it's not because the screenwriters are able to just by themselves create those tensions. It's because this has certain social commentary to it, and because some of the traditions that it's commenting on, because those are like an external force, like an external strength, like that's what sort of creates attention to this movie due to no virtue of its own screenwriting beyond merely picking a good subject. So, like, I think that there's a certain unfortunate lack of professionalism that, you know, Risto Jarva just chose to like-minded screenwriters who would never properly counterbalance him or, you know, properly criticize his native tendencies the way that Kurosawa in his best period brought screenwriters to show him which are his, you know, which is his A material and which is his B material, you know, a couple of American examples would be that, you know, what people might see as Quentin Tarantino's best screenplay is just about the only screenplay where he had a co-writer. Like, if people see that Woody Allen had better classics in, like, late 70s, early 80s, he had a co-writer in there. You know, Billy Wilder, for instance, he had two major co-writers, was it Charles Brackett early on, and then I.A.L. Diamond later on. So, like, when Wilder's co-writer changed, the Charles Brackett movies have a completely different tonality than the International Algebra League later films. So, you know, just saying that if directors on the level of Kurosawa, Billy Wilder, and say Tarantino, Woody Allen at their best, if they can, you know, accept a co-pilot, like, you know, like if Kurosawa can have his ideas criticized by his collaborators, like, you know, you'd think that Finnish directors would also allow themselves, you know, that kind of, you know, would willingly take that kind of high road. But, you know, like, the best and worst in this movie is because it's made by like-minded people. So, I'm sure the co-writers, Jaakko Pakkasvirta and Petra von Baak, I'm sure they contributed to this movie becoming something more than what it would have been if Risto Jarva would have just written it himself. But again, just like with Kuuma, Kissa, the kind of because this is just a movie that believes in its own message, and because it believes in its own message so absolutely, and because it doesn't really believe that there's anything worthy against it, it's just sort of rendering itself slightly mindless and experience because of that. And that's why it could have been better. But just like that Kuuma Kissa movie, I actually think that there's something worthy about it. So, like, if international audiences saw this, I'm sure, like, this could find some admiration. Anyway, like, it just occurred to me whilst watching this movie, where if I explain the plot of it, I would say that, this is a science fiction movie, and, you know, like, aesthetically it's science fiction the way Godard's Alpha will is science fiction. So, like, you know, lots of nighttime shots around city and sort of eclectically picking, like, a couple of the more, you know, modern parts of Helsinki to sort of, be able to go through a low-budget art science fiction film. Aesthetically, it's sort of, it's a bit like Alphaville, you know, lots of indoor scenes just for budgetary reasons, I suppose the production values, they have a kind of charm on some level, but I thought the limitations became something that was holding the movie back, just for me. That's how I judged it. But you know, like, if I'd read reviews from the time, there's one that says, Ruusujen aikaan ajatuksellisesti varmasti kehittyneen ja monipuolisin elokuva, mitä Suomessa on koskaan tehty. The Time of the Roses is probably the most intellectually advanced kind of movie that has ever been produced in Finland, said one reviewer. And then another reviewer said, epäilemättä Ruusujen aikaan Risto Jarvan toistaiseksi merkittävin saavutus. Uskaltaisiko sanoa suomalaisen elokuvan mestariteos? So, without a doubt, Time of the Roses is Risto Jarva's best film so far. Would one dare to say that it's the masterpiece of Finnish cinema? Some of the reviewers of the time thought that this was a huge deal, and they certainly didn't think that it was a film of limitations. But as I said, to me, these films have aged very poorly as a rule. That the Finnish New Wave movies have aged far more poorly than, say, the Japanese New Wave movies. So I don't think Vivre sa vie by Godard, I don't think that film has aged. Shoot the Piano Player by Truffaut, I don't think that has aged. Insect Woman by Shohei Imamura, I don't think that has aged. There are some New Wave movies that could legitimately, I think, be seen as just as fresh as when they came out. But some of these certainly aren't that. This came out in 1968, so rather late as far as the New Wave was concerned. So is it 9 years after Breathless? The two main touchstones to this, I think, are Blow Up by Michelangelo Antonioni and 2001 A Space Odyssey. So how you know, how Kubrick showed the future with like this kind of unfussy, you know, functionalism that form follows function, as some people say. Like, this clearly tries to model itself. Actually, not that I think about it, like, did 2001 A Space Odyssey say, did it come out in 1969? So perhaps, like, the filmmakers hadn't seen that, but, like, you know, like, the kind of 60s fashions that were sort of self-consciously aiming towards some kind of futurism, like, if 2001 A Space Odyssey hadn't come before, then this film merely has the same influences as what Kubrick was drawing from. But anyway, Blow Up by Antonioni, like, that and 2001 are the kind of the most obvious art house movie links. So anyway, this movie, it's about a documentary maker in the future, where it's interesting how this movie, you could almost say, predicted that what would follow socialism would be liberalism. And this movie is actually an anti-liberal movie, because it's basically pro-socialist. And it's the kind of movie where, like, how it depicts the future is that there is still, there is a class society where there are some people at the top, and the people at the top have the control. And then there's the everyone else who don't have the control. And what the movie is talking about is that the people who have the control talk, how they present society is that society has solved all the problems, and because liberalism cares about everything, there are no longer problems in society, because, you know, like, society is allegedly some sort of a masterpiece of egalitarianism. But, like, this is a movie that's calling out the privileged liberals who, they basically want to maintain the status quo, and they want to maintain their own position on the driver's seat, and they don't want to give equal control to everyone else in society. And just like the David Hemmings character in Blow Up, he's basically an oblivious person. The story of Blow Up, and by the way, I have I made a video about what I see as the subtext of Blow Up, so if you're interested in seeing my more in-depth thoughts, I'll put it on YouTube. But anyway, just like David Hemmings in Blow Up, the movie is about him being oblivious, essentially. And this movie, likewise, it's about the documentary maker also being oblivious. As far as that is concerned, I think this movie has something interesting going for it. And, you know, the ending, it sort of reminded me a bit of Renoir's French Can-Can, of, you know, how the documentary maker, when he sees what he has produced, he has to get so drunk because he can't stand his own, you know, he can't stand his own contributions in a way. But anyway, that's just, on some level, you know, like, just scratching the surface of what's going on in this movie, because like, this very prominently goes about how it's very much influenced by Alfred Hitchcock's Vertigo, which, like if this movie would be like discovered by international audiences, I think that vertigo type angle might be what some people see as the greatest achievement of this movie. And you know, like I will say that it's an interesting layer to it. So they are like when the liberal documentary maker, when he's doing a piece that's meant to show why modern times are superior to the past, they are picking moments from the past where something that was supposedly wrong in the past is supposedly no longer part of the present. So, you know, bad moments of the past are meant to show the present in a favorable light. But like one of the situations that comes is that it's actually shown that the past and the present are actually, they are no different. That the supposedly more advanced present is merely it's merely a more hypocritical version of the past, and that's where that like vertigo thing comes up, where they are showing you know, that there's like an exploited model in the past, and they are recreating her life in the present. But then the film is sort of playing around with the ideas that, you know, like, is the woman supposedly not being exploited in the present? And the liberal is saying that, no, society has solved all the problems, exploitation no longer takes place. And yet the woman, she doesn't quite feel that way. So the vertical level is that there's the woman in the past and then the modern woman who is pretending to be the woman from the past, and then the film's playing around with those levels and juxtapositions and so on. So anyway, I'd almost say that this is certainly like if Kuuma, Kissa was like a more intellectual version of Kuu on vaarallinen, I'd say that like this is a more intellectual version of that Kuuma, Kissa movie. So like this is almost like like you could almost halfway see this as like almost meta commentary ish about industry practices such as paying women to take their clothes off and then filming them, you know, as far as the script is concerned, I think there's a lot of quality and even something that you could see as like properly intellectual content. I just think that the script could have been even better if it could have had a slightly more formidable type of counterbalancing internally. But like as far as the script is concerned, I think this is quite accomplished and could even be like a minor international classic. But as far as the direction is concerned, I was disappointed with the cheapness, basically. And the way that was it the secretary of the documentary filmmaker, like the way that she basically walks around in, like she basically walks around naked, like she's having some sort of a shirt slash dress on, but like the way that she has clothes on is like it's difficult, like it's almost like synthesizing the conditions of having clothes on and being naked at the same time. Like it's just like that kind of 60s-ness, like I mean I just I found it I find it unpleasant to watch. Like it just looks so cheap, and like I don't think that that's like any kind of I don't think that's any kind of postmodern way of saying how women are in cinema. I think that that is genuinely, like trying to sell the movie with its sexiness. So like it's like I had the feeling like the movie's sort of like in a somewhat hypocritical manner, denouncing nudity in cinema whilst clearly using it as a selling point. But anyway, that's not to say that the film in this, sorry, that the script in this film wouldn't have something fully worthy. Like, there are interesting moments enough that I think out of all Finnish Nouvelle movies, this is the one that's almost the easiest to recommend to international audiences. I have no idea how international audiences might feel about it, but like certainly if you're gonna recommend anything, this is gonna have to be almost at the top of the list. Anyway, yeah, I thought that, my briefest review of Ruusujen and Aika is that the script is great, the direction is subpar, and I'm not blaming Risto Jarva because he has shown that he has produced first-rate material, and he certainly a steady hand as a director in his best work. I just think that trying to do film of this level in Finland with the kind of the production budget was just way too cheap to make this movie look as big as it should have been. So like I think Alphaville is sort of masterful in dancing around its cost cutting. That Alphaville is probably just as cheap, but it doesn't quite look as cheap as this. But anyway, like if I'd compare this to Alphaville, this had a couple of elements that annoyed me, such as the secretary basically walking around naked. I don't find it sexy, I don't find it amusing, I don't find it cute. It's just I thought it was something I held against the movie. But like this had a couple of elements that sort of annoyed me, but if those individual items that are sort of a minor thing in the movie, if those were ignored, I think you could see this as just as good as Alphaville. But anyway, I'm starting to run out of time with this video as well, so perhaps we should start wrapping up. So anyway, Ruusujen Aika, I would basically, I think that this movie is just good enough for me to give my approval to it. I think this is, if there's anything, in a bigger way, if there's anything wrong with this movie, it's because it's more ambitious than the production company is giving it a chance to reach. This, as far as a low-budget art house sci-fi is concerned, I think this is perfectly accomplished in that field. I think this is sort of in the ballpark of Alphaville. So if some like that, perhaps they could also like this. Who knows? Just a couple of unfortunately dated 60s elements. If those weren't here, I think this could be like a proper minor classic, perhaps even a proper classic of Finnish cinema. But to me, I'd say that it's just good enough. This was This was my supplementary video to the other new video, but now I don't feel like I need to do anymore. But anyway, leave some comments if you feel the need. But anyway, that was all for me. Thank you, and bye-bye.